Okay, real quick, I'm going to knock off a quick task on the sills, and that's putting the safety striping on them. You guys have seen this before. I've made another video on the SD70M, the Athergenesis unit I had, about putting the sill striping on. So you pretty much know how to do this. But for any newcomers here to my channel that are seeing this video first, let me go ahead and go over this real fast, very briefly here. Okay, so this is Western Safety reflective tape. This is available at Harbor Freight for about 10 bucks a roll. It comes in the sheets of black and yellow. What I do is I cut out the yellow strips and I take a metal straight edge, preferably a metal straight edge. You want it to have a nice sharp clean edge. A brand new X-Acto blade in my number 2 X-Acto here, and I cut out relatively large strips. I'll zoom in here. These are a little bit larger than the strips you would find on rail cars because they're covering locomotive sills, so they're a little bit bigger. You guys can see that. I cut them out. I do several at a time because it takes quite a few to cover a locomotive sill entirely. And then I just take and I basically apply them to the sills of the locomotive. Now you're probably wondering how I get past these little holes, because we do have to put the stanchions back in there. Well, what I like to do, and I will flip this over to the opposite side where I've already done the sill striping. Okay, notice how you have these little black dots above the openings for the stanchions. What I do is I take acrylic black paint, I just put a little dot above the stanchions so I know where to cut the tape. Basically what I do is I put the entire strips on, and then I just cut out the little notches for the stanchions so that they fit snugly over that and you can't see the overlapping, which is really nice. It's my little technique to get away with that, and it works well. I cut around the little warning labels and stuff to preserve them. However, you could go over these, and if you have the decals, you can put the decals back over onto the tape with the little white glue. That's one way to remedy that, but I usually just cut around them, and you can see they look really good once you put them on. And I've already done this back anti-climber as well. This has the reflective tape on it. I still need to do the front anti-climber, and I need to basically go ahead and do this whole sill here. So I'm going to go ahead and do that now, and I'll come back. Alright, there's the completed safety striping now. You guys can see it's on. It looks pretty good. Cut out the little notches for the stanchions. But it's just another one of those little aspects of realism, I think, that really adds another nice touch to a model. It's amazing how much that really looks so cool. It's crazy. So now that we got that out of the way, we can focus on the fuel tank. So the Athergen unit doesn't come with any kind of fuel tank piping or detailing, but you can see that there are pipes all over the fuel tank of the real 2203, and we're going to add those. And I have plenty of parts left over. Some will have to scratch build and modify, like this breather pipe here. There's some other tank details on the back and on the conductor side as well, or engineer side rather, that we'll have to add. I'll go ahead and show you guys that real quick. Alrighty, so real quickly I'll go over the parts that I have laid out here. These are specifically for the fuel tank, which I've taken off the model. On the fuel tank on the prototype, there's some minor details. These are all pretty much standard to EMD fuel tanks for SD60s, as far as I can see. The only difference is that Union Pacific and a couple other roads will put the waste retention tanks, which is this guy right here, on the backs of the engines. But before I get into how I made this real quick, I'll go ahead and show you the other basic parts. This little guy here is a filter box, and it goes on the front of the tank, which is on the prototype. This is that short breather pipe that's on the conductor side front of the fuel tank. And this guy here is the breather pipe that'll go on the back of the conductor side fuel tank. These are the drain bars, or the drip guards, basically. One goes on the front of the fuel tank, one goes on the back. These parts here, since I went ahead and was doing all of the styrene modifications I needed, I went ahead and made the bases of the knuckle brackets for the rear pilot, which the spare knuckles will go onto. We'll add those in a little bit. So I thought I'd just show those real quick, because I went ahead and cut them out while I was doing all the other styrene modifications. Getting into the waste retention tank before we install them here. This is made from styrene. I scratch build these. There are some parts available. Basically what I do is I detail them up with some Detail Associates parts from an MU cable set, or an MU jumper set. And they have all of these like little hatches and bolt details, which are similar, very close to how they are on a waste retention tank. Plus you got a little sight gauge here, this little stump sticking out. So it's not a 100% accurate, but it's pretty damn close to a real waste retention tank. So once we add this to the model, we can paint all of these parts. At this stage in time, though, you could paint these separately and then install them, but then what's going to happen is you stand a chance of getting glue residue on the parts, and then you have to touch them up again, which is kind of, you know, annoying. So I like to just go ahead and install them first and then paint over them. That way, if there's any glue residue, any imperfections like that, they'll get covered up and blended in. So I'll go ahead and install these. I won't show that part. But basically with the SD60s, it's nice. The SD40-2s and some of the other engines that Athearn offers, you can remove the fuel tanks. This one is basically like a pop-off, pop-on part, so it's pretty simple. But basically what I'll do once I install all the parts, I'll just permanently attach this to the chassis of the engine. But that's pretty self-explanatory, so I'll go ahead and add these details and we'll come back and I'll show you guys the completed fuel tank. So here are the parts installed. You can see those. Here's the back. At this point, it's ready for paint. We'll touch this up and we can reinstall it on the fuel tank. I'm also going to go ahead and start installing these knuckle brackets on the back. I won't show that. I'll just go ahead and get them out of the way. It's a simple process of attaching these to the pilot, so it's nothing we need to focus on too much. Okay, so off camera, I had actually taken and put some putty over my class lights that I had filled in, or taken off rather. I want to put the putty on there just to make sure I fill in any little scratches and imperfections that I had noticed earlier in the process, even after sanding. I want to smooth these out just real quick before I touch up the paint on those later. So what I'm going to use is a very fine sanding stick to start with. You guys can see it's a Squadron fine stick, and I'm going to take the butt end of this, and again, just take it at an angle and start sanding these. I'm going to do this for each. And you just make a circular motion around the part, and it creates a nice, smooth, even sanding. And I'll just go over, sand this flat. You can see it takes the majority of that putty off, but what happens is it fills in all those cracks. It's really nice. I'll go ahead and repeat this with this side here. Okay, so I've installed a Details West speed recorder, the little outlet here that's attached to the bearing. Now, I don't like to use the original brass cables just because I think they're a little clunky. I like to use wire parts also because they're a little more flexible, they're a little bit more prone, because a lot of times stuff can rub up against the trucks, and I like to just have that extra precaution. So I like to use light bulb wire for these models, stuff like this. So I've cut this to size, and looking at prototype photos, I've bent it basically to the correct shape, and I'm going to attach it like this and install it. Now, I'm not going to be able to show this process again, unfortunately, just because I need to be able to get in here. But it's basically going to look something like this when it's installed. So once I do that, I'll paint it with everything else. Okay, so another important detail we got to add are actually the last two details I'm going to put on this model for the moment. And that is the MU receptacles, covers, and we're going to make the ditch lights here. This is a Details or a Detail Associates part, the ditch lights. I prefer to use these. I don't like the Details West parts as much because they're harder to work with because of their pewter metal. Also because they don't make an accurate part for this particular style of ditch light in particular. Union Pacific uses a special stand ditch light. They're the only ones to really use this style. They make them themselves, I believe, for their locomotives. And they're just pretty simple. They're just mounted on a piece of sheet metal and then welded to the deck or the platform or pilot of the engine, whatever you want to call it. And it's pretty simple, and thus they're pretty simple to make, even though they're not readily available. Really easy to do here, and I'm going to show you just real fast. So I have the part here. This is what they look like right out of the package. So we're going to use the ditch lights first. I'll install the receptacles in a little bit, so we'll just go ahead and set this aside. I have the ditch light housings, if I can get them in the shot here. There they are. These are them after I've taken them off the sprue, cleaned them up a little bit, and to my right here, I have a sheet of 0.15-inch, or I think this is, yeah, 0.15-inch gauge sheet styrene. This is what we're going to be using for the main platform, or the backing of the ditch light. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to take just a small dab of glue. It was actually a little too much, but it'll be alright. I'm going to take and spread this around a piece of wire. I can sand the extra off later. Basically what you're going to do you're going to take your ditch light, both of them, and we're just going to set them in the glue, like that. We're going to let these dry for a little bit before we cut them. Don't try to cut these out right away, get anxious or anything like that, because all you're going to do is just break them off and you don't have to re-glue them and then you're going to have a mess. It's best to just wait. So we'll let this set aside for a second and I'll go ahead and install the receptacles and we'll come back to the ditch lights in a second. Alrighty, so looking at the back pilot real quick, I'm going to go ahead and install the receptacle. These are really easy to do. I have one here on my end of my blade. It's cut to size. I'm going to back the tripod up real fast. I'm just going to... I'm looking at prototype photos to get an exact reference. They're usually just above the MU cables themselves. Go ahead and set that one. It's directly under the anti-climber. Alright, so that's about right there. I'm going to take a needle. Just pop it off really carefully. Like that. So, it's not too crazy, you can tell. But I'm going to go ahead and install another one on this side. Same thing with the front pilot. Alright, so these are the ditch lights after I've cut them out. You guys can see they look pretty good. And they're just on those styrene bases, like I said. I've made some more little pieces that I've already installed to the pilot at the front of the engine. And I'm just going to go ahead and place these onto the model. And we can paint them later. So there's the ditch lights installed, ready to go. At this point, we're going to start painting some of these detail parts. There's a lot of paint touch-up we need to do. I took the nose off the model because, long story short, I took the shell off to put a decoder in, and the sub bases of the cab actually snapped off, and now they're really crooked, and the frame won't sit right on the shell, so I gotta fix this before I can put that back on. I won't worry about showing that, though. We'll just stay focused on the model, and we'll go ahead and start painting these parts. Alrighty, I got the parts painted at this point. They're looking pretty good. The locomotive's really coming along here. Still got a lot to do, but for the most part, the detail work is complete. I've got to add a few more things, but I'm waiting until I get most of the parts on, and then we can finish it off. So what I got so far, I got the snow plow. It is now finished. You guys can see how good that looks. Really nice. So repainted with the charcoal gray or hibernous gray, whatever you want to call it. And then I painted the grab irons white. So that's the snow plow. The nose is touched up. It's repainted. So it looks pretty good. Took the class lights off, if you remember, and we touched up the paint on that. So that's ready to be reinstalled. The fuel tank took a little bit longer just because there was a lot of white parts I needed to repaint. You can see the painted area. Remember, this will get tucked in and it'll get weathered over pretty well, so you won't even see any of this paint, the difference in the shades of paint. So we won't worry about that too much. We can see the drain bar, everything's painted. Back's all painted up. Here we go. There's the waste retention tank, pipe, and everything. The details are touched up on the front of the tank here as well, these guys. So it looks pretty good. I'm debating right now whether I want to go ahead and weather the fuel tank before I install it, or weather it with the engine. We'll see. I'll go ahead and set that aside. As for the locomotive, we got the cab details painted up. You can see those. The AC units painted appropriately now. I did add this Details West conduit to the cab roof. You guys can see that. Touched up all the paint on the roof. On the front pilot, the ditch lights are now painted. As we go down here, the roof for the area around the horn has been repainted, the stand's repainted. So that's looking pretty good. I really like that touch. Back pilot's almost completed now. I got most of the parts painted. The knuckle brackets, we'll get the spare knuckles after they're done, or after the locomotive's weathered. I did go ahead and install the train line air hose. It's not completely painted yet, but it's installed and it's bent to the appropriate shape. So I'll have to add the air hose to the front, but I'll wait till I reinstall the snow plow here to put the train line hose on the front pilot. I also got to install the receptacles on the front pilot. That's the other thing I got to do, but we'll worry about that later. And then the front, the truck, the speed recorder, that's painted as well. So it's really coming along. We got the majority of the work done. Sorry about that. It's taking a little while, but it's really starting to look good. Pretty happy with it. So I'll go ahead and reinstall the snowplow and we'll keep going. Alright, so I put the snowplow back on the pilot. It's glued and sealed in place. We'll go ahead and put the train line hose in front. Just very carefully, I'll guide it into a little area here. Alrighty, so we finally have the locomotive detailed and it's partially assembled. I'm going to keep the handrails off until we start doing the weathering. And you guys will see how I start putting them on slowly. Usually I'll put the front and rear handrails on first. That way, once I get the pilots weathered, I can put those on. And I'll weather the handrails separately too, as you'll see. All kinds of little steps like that, little tricks like that. Especially because we're going to need to do the walkways. And we're going to need to be able to get full access to the hood, the cab and everything like that, and the handrails will get in the way. That's why we took those off, but you guys will see how I work around those and when we put them back on too in the second step. But for the most part, the detailing is completed on this model and we're ready to move on for weathering. I will make a weathering video for this locomotive separately. I'll start filming that here pretty soon, the next couple days, maybe a week's time or so, we'll see. But anyways, that's about it for now, and when we come back, we'll start weathering this beautiful model. So stay tuned for more, guys. See you in a bit.